Hello everyone, welcome back to this video lecture series. This video is dedicated to Einstein's model of lattice specific heat. Einstein in 1911 was the first to make an attempt to resolve the discrepancies of the classical model of specific heat by replacing the classical oscillators by quantum oscillators, which have only discrete energy values in accordance with Planck's quantum theory. Einstein replaced the classical oscillators with quantum oscillators in accordance with quantum theory. Since these oscillators follow quantum theory, their energies must be discrete. With this, Einstein tried to explain the specific heat of solids, and this model was called as Einstein's theory of specific heat of solids, or sometimes it is also referred as quantum theory of specific heat. This model was based on some assumptions. Here in this model, Einstein retained some of the assumptions which were made in the classical theory, and he added new assumptions to explain the specific heat of solids. The first assumption: atoms in a solid are identical and independent of each other. That is, they do not interact with each other. Second assumption: a solid consisting of n atoms, which are symmetrically arranged in three dimensions, is equivalent to 3n linear harmonic oscillators, that is, one-dimensional harmonic oscillators. The first two assumptions are borrowed from the classical model itself. The third assumption, which makes the difference between classical and the quantum model, in this assumption, all the oscillators vibrate with the same natural frequency, omega naught, due to their identical environment, and the possible energies of vibration are given by En is equal to n h cross omega naught. This is in accordance with Planck's quantum theory. Here n is the quantum number which can take up only the discrete set of values 1, 2, 3. So, the energies associated with the vibration of the oscillators is quantized. And h cross is equal to h divided by 2 pi, where h is the Planck's constant. Thus, the oscillators are quantum mechanical in nature and have discrete energy spectrum rather than continuous one, as in the case of classical oscillators. Since this model is based on the quantum theory, it obeys the quantum statistics, that is Bose-Einstein statistics, and hence any number of oscillators may be present in the same quantum state. Now, with these assumptions, Einstein obtained an expression for lattice specific heat, which overcomes the limitation of classical theory to certain extent. Now, let us arrive at the expression for lattice specific heat using this model. Since this model is based on the quantum statistics, according to quantum statistics, the average energy of the oscillator is given by E average is equal to h cross omega naught divided by e to the power of h cross omega naught divided by kT minus 1. This is the expression for average energy, which is in accordance with quantum statistics. If there are n atoms in 1 kilomole of the solid, then there are 3n such linear oscillators, and the total energy of the solid is equal to total number of linear oscillators into average energy of each oscillator. That is equal to, using the equation 1, we get 3n h cross omega naught divided by e to the power of h cross omega naught by kt minus 1. This is the expression for total internal energy of the solid consisting of 3n linear harmonic oscillators. Therefore, the molar specific heat of the solid is given by, we know the definition of molar specific heat at constant volume, Cv is equal to du by dt. That is, the change in internal energy with temperature at constant volume gives us the molar specific heat. Now, substituting for internal energy U from the above equation, we get, and substituting and differentiating this, we get 3n h cross omega naught into, the differentiation of this term is, this is looking like 1 by x, differentiation of this is minus 1 by x square. So, minus 1 divided by e to the power of h cross omega naught minus 1 minus k, e to the power of h cross omega naught by kt minus 1 whole square into differentiation of this inner function is e to the power of h cross omega naught by kt into differentiation of this inner function is equal to h cross omega naught by k into 1 minus 1 by t square. Now, simplifying this, we get 3n h cross omega naught. First, let us write the terms. 3n k into h cross omega naught by kt whole square. This is simplified version. Here, let me write one step here. 3n h cross omega naught into h cross omega naught by k into minus it to minus it will become plus 1 by t square into e to the power of h cross omega naught by kt divided by e to the power of h cross omega naught by kt minus 1 whole square. Now, observe here, in this term, let us write this term as 3n k, let us multiply and divide by k. So, 3n k h cross square omega naught square divided by k square t square. So, the equation reduces to 3n k into h cross omega naught by kt whole square into e to the power of h cross omega naught by kt divided by e to the power of h cross omega naught by kt minus 1 whole square. Here, the quantity h cross omega naught by k, let us take this as equal to theta e, which has the dimensions of temperature and it is called as Einstein temperature. Einstein introduced the term, he took h cross omega naught by k is equal to theta e, and he called it as Einstein temperature. Now, substituting h cross omega naught by k is equal to theta e in this equation, we get Cv is equal to 3nk. H cross omega naught by k can be replaced by theta e by t whole square into e to the power of theta e by t divided by e to the power of theta e by t minus 1 whole square. This gives us the expression for lattice specific heat according to quantum model and is called as Einstein's equation for lattice specific heat. Now let us discuss the different situations, how the specific heat varies with temperature. The major discrepancy found in case of classical model is that specific heat is not a constant, but it varies with respect to temperature. Now, this temperature variation of specific heat, Einstein explained the variation of specific heat with temperature by considering the different situations. Let us consider the first case in the high temperature limit. At high temperatures, KT is much greater than H cross omega naught, or T is much greater than H cross omega naught by K. Or simply we can say that T is much greater than theta E. It means when the temperature is greater than the Einstein's temperature. Now, let us consider e to the power of theta E by T. That becomes, since temperature T is much greater than theta E, we can approximate it to expanding this 1 plus theta E by T plus 1 divided by 2 factorial into theta E by T whole square and higher order terms. Since theta is much greater than theta E, we can neglect the higher order terms and we can write e to the power of theta E by T is approximately equal to 1 plus theta E by T. For large values of temperature, higher order terms can be neglected. So, the exponential term reduces to 1 plus theta E by T. Therefore, the equation, this equation reduces to what we can write is Cv is equal to 3nk theta E by T whole square. In place of e to the power of theta E by T, we can substitute 1 plus theta E by T, and in the denominator e to the power of theta E by T can be replaced by 1 plus theta E by T minus 1. So simplifying this further, we get 3nk into theta E by T whole square into 1 plus theta E by T divided by theta E by T whole square. So this theta E by T whole square cancels. We get 3nk into 1 plus theta E by T. Now, as T tends to infinity, theta E by T tends to 0. Hence, at higher temperatures, we can neglect this term. So, the expression for specific heat capacity reduces to, we can write 3nk into 1 plus theta E by T can be approximated to 3nk. If we take one mole of the solid, then the number of atoms or the number of harmonic oscillators is equal to Avogadro number. So, the product of Avogadro number and Boltzmann constant gives us universal gas constant R. So, Cv is equal to 3R at high temperatures. Thus, at high temperatures, the value of specific heat capacity Cv approaches asymptotically to the classical result obtained by Dulong-Petit-Law. So, at high temperature, the classic quantum model reduces to classical model. This is as shown in the figure. Here, the dotted lines, dots represent the experimental results. This is the classical value, which is in accordance with the Dulong-Petit's law. This is the Einstein's theoretical curve, and the dots represent the experimental values. Here we have three different parts in this graph. The dotted line represents the classical limit obtained by Dulong-Petit's law. The thick line represents the Einstein's theoretical curve. And the dots represents the experimental values. Now from this graph it is clear that as we move to the higher and higher temperatures, the Einstein's curve approaches asymptotically the classical result. So it is in accordance with Dulong-Petit law. Now at low temperature limit, let us consider the second case, the behavior of the value of specific heat at low temperatures. At low temperatures, KT is much smaller than H cross omega naught, or T is much smaller than H cross omega naught by K. That implies the temperature is much smaller than Einstein's temperature. Therefore, e to the power of theta E by T minus 1, we can take it as approximately equal to e to the power of theta E by T, because since theta E is much larger, the exponential term starts dominating, so we can neglect the term 1 in the equation. We can take it as approximately equal to e to the power of theta E by T. Now substituting this in the Einstein's expression for specific heat, we get Cv is equal to 3nk theta E by T whole square e to the power of theta E by T divided by e to the power of theta E minus theta E by T minus 1 can be simply expressed as e to the power of theta E by T whole square. So 1 e to the power of theta E by T cancels, and we get Cv is equal to 3r, taking nk is equal to 3r, assuming that the solid has one mole of atoms. N is equal to Avogadro number. Theta E by T whole square into e to the power of minus theta E by T. Now observe here, we have the term, exponential term on the RHS. It indicates that at low temperatures, the exponential term is the dominating factor and is more important than theta E by T in determining the variation of specific heat with the temperature. We have two terms involving the temperature, but this exponential term is more dominating than this first term, 1 by T square term. So we can conclude that with the decrease in temperature, specific heat capacity of a solid at low temperatures decreases exponentially with decrease in temperature. So Einstein's model explains the variation of specific heat capacity at low temperatures, which is the experimentally observed fact, which could not be explained by classical model. So, according to Einstein model, at high temperatures, the classical model and quantum model does not make any much difference. Both of them will approach to a constant value. Whereas at low temperatures, according to Einstein model, the specific heat capacity decreases exponentially with the decrease in temperature, which is somewhat comparable to experimental results. Now let us understand the term Einstein temperature and its importance. For every solid, there is a characteristic temperature above which the Einstein's model is valid, and well below this value, the model fails. This temperature is called as Einstein temperature. The Einstein's model is valid only above the particular characteristic temperature of the solid, and that temperature is called as Einstein temperature. Thus, we can define the Einstein temperature as that characteristic temperature above which a solid behaves like Einstein's solid. And we already know the expression for theta E, Einstein's temperature. It is given by H cross omega E by K, where omega E is called as Einstein's frequency. The significance of this Einstein's temperature is, it is the temperature, characteristic temperature, which distinguishes between high temperature and low temperature behavior of the solid. How it behaves at higher temperatures and lower temperatures is distinguished by using the Einstein temperature. Above the Einstein temperature, the behavior of the solid can be explained by using Einstein's model. Below that temperature, Einstein's model is not applicable. Now let us understand some merits and demerits of this Einstein's model. At high temperatures, the atomic heat capacity asymptotically approaches to 3R, which is in agreement with the experimental facts. At low temperatures, the atomic heat capacity decreases with decrease in temperature. Also, as T approaches to zero, CV approaches to zero. So, this is in accordance with the experimental facts. So, this is the success of Einstein's model. Now, let us understand some demerits. In most respects, the Einstein's model has been a remarkable success. Its results are in good agreement with the experiments over most of the temperature range. However, it has certain demerits also. Now let us list out the demerits of Einstein's model. It explains the specific heat curves up to a certain point, having the temperatures around 2 times the Einstein's temperature, but fails at extremely low temperatures, at which the atomic heat capacity decreases more rapidly than that predicted by Einstein. Einstein's theory predicts that at low temperatures, CV varies inversely as exponential of the temperature. But experimental observation shows that it varies more rapidly than that predicted by Einstein's theory. The values of theta E and omega naught, that is the Einstein's characteristic temperature and the Einstein's characteristic frequency, are obtained empirically and cannot be verified from any other independent physical data. There is no independent physical data which verifies the values of theta E and omega naught. Einstein himself recognized that the assumption of monochromatic vibrations, that is, all the harmonic oscillators will vibrate with the same frequency, that was the major assumption made by Einstein. That assumption of monochromatic vibrations was oversimplified approach and does not correspond to the actual facts. In fact, in the actual solid, the atomic vibrations will not have a single frequency, but it is spread over a wide frequency range. The vibrations of a particular atom must be very complex indeed, because it is under the force field of n vibrating atoms. This is the major drawback of Einstein's model, which was overcome by Debye by assuming that the linear harmonic oscillators will not vibrate with the same frequency, but they have a finite frequency spectrum.